everyone! Welcome back to integralcalc.com. Today we're going to be finding the area that's bounded by one polar loop, or the polar area bounded by one loop of this polar equation. So we've been given the equation r equals 2 cosine of 4 theta, and I've gone ahead and done some work ahead of time and graphed it on a Cartesian coordinate system and then graphed it on a polar coordinate system as well. Remember that graphing, the first thing you should do is you've got this trigonometric identity cosine. You're looking for what's inside of that. That's 4 theta. You want to set that equal to pi over 2. That's the easiest way to do it. Then solve for theta. So in this case, we get theta equals pi over 8. You want to block off your x-axis, or in this case, your theta axis, in increments of pi over 8. So we've changed our Cartesian coordinate system into a coordinate system where x is equal to theta, right? We've got the theta axis here, and the y-axis is equal to r. So you're blocking off your theta axis in increments of pi over 8, which I've done, pi over 8, then pi over 4, then 3 pi over 8. Then you want to go ahead and plug in 0, 4, theta, and when you do that, you'll get this point here, 0, 2, right? So you plot that, then you plug in pi over 8, pi over 4, 3 pi over 8, and you plot these points along this axis. And that makes it a lot easier to translate this graph onto a polar coordinate system. So the way that we do that is we look at this first point here, which is at 0, 2. Now, with a polar coordinate system, remember that in polar coordinates, you care about the angle, right? And the angle here, the angle theta is equal to 0, and as you move in this direction, right, the angle over here becomes pi. As the angle comes back, it comes back to 2 pi. So you care about the angle theta, and then r is just the distance from the origin. So for example, a point right here might be at the coordinates pi over 4, comma 2, which would be an angle of pi over 4 from the x-axis here, and then out a distance of 2. So again, in this case, right, we have when theta for this point here, when theta is equal to 0, r is equal to 2. So when the angle is equal to 0, which is right here along the x-axis, when the angle is equal to 0, we're out from the origin a distance of 2, and that's why we get this point right here. And so we just graph. As the graph approaches right here, as the graph approaches the angle pi over 8, the distance away from the origin becomes 0, right? It comes into 0. R is equal to 0 right there. So notice that we've got the angle pi over 8 marked off here. As the graph approaches that angle, it gets sucked in to the origin here, right? It approaches that angle and then it comes back in and gets sucked in to the origin at a distance from the origin of 0. And so that's how we graph, and we just continue to graph it. And the reason that I like to graph things is because it makes it a lot easier to visualize what we're looking for in this problem. And in this case, we're looking for the area bounded by one of these loops. This is going to become like a flower with, I believe it's 8 loops. Yeah, 8 loops. And we're looking for the area of one of them. So most importantly, we're going to concern ourselves with the area of this loop here, the one right here, and this would be like this. So we're going to concern ourselves with the area of that loop. And the reason that we're going to pick that particular loop is because we're going to use those limits of integration. So what we need to do is realize first that we're going to be integrating on the range 0 to 8. So we're going to be integrating from when the angle equals 0 to when the angle equals pi over 8. So we're going to go ahead and start plugging these things into our area equation. So we're going to start when the angle equals 0, and we're going to stop when the angle is equal to pi over 8. But that's only going to give us this top half of the loop, right? Because how we graphed this, we started at 0, we come back into the origin right here, and we've only got this top half of the loop done. We haven't closed off the bottom half. So that means that we're going to have to, in order to find the area of the entire loop, we're going to have to multiply this whole integral by 2 to get the area of the full loop. So I'm going to go ahead and put that 2 out in front. Then we've got 1/2, which is part of our formula, and then f of theta, which is our original equation, r equals 2 cosine of 4 theta. So we go ahead and plug in 2 cosine of 4 theta, and we're going to square that. And then, of course, we've got d theta. So now it's just a matter of evaluating this integral on that range. So to do so, we can see, first of all, that this 2 and this 1/2 are going to cancel. And now we can just go ahead and take the, or square 2 cosine of 4 theta to start simplifying this integral. So when we do that, we'll get the integral from 0 to pi over 8 of 4 cosine squared of 4 theta d theta. So now we've got this nasty cosine squared of 4 theta, which we really don't want to have to deal with, because trying to integrate cosine squared is sort of difficult. So what we're going to do is use u substitution to try to get rid of it. And we're going to go ahead and set u equal to 4 theta. So remember, from u substitution, you set u equal to 4 theta. You take the derivative du, which is just going to be 4. And then, of course, because you took the derivative, you have to add on here d theta. Then you want to go ahead and solve for d theta. And to do that, you'll divide both sides by 4 and get d theta equals du over 4. So now, if we plug back into our integral, we'll get the integral from 0 to pi over 8 of 4 cosine squared of u, and then d theta is equal to du over 4. So we can see right away that this 4 and this 4 are going to cancel, and now we're just left with the integral from 0 to pi over 8 of cosine squared of u du. And at this point, we can go ahead and involve our double angle formula, which I've gone ahead and written up here in the formula bar. Whenever you have a chance to use a double angle formula to get rid of a cosine squared and turn it into something that doesn't involve a higher order trigonometric identity, you want to probably go ahead and do that, because it makes things easier. So since we just have cosine squared of u, we'll go ahead and make this substitution. And we'll get a equals the integral from 0 to pi over 8. And cosine squared of u is now going to become 1/2 times 1 plus cosine of 2u d theta. So at this point, let's see, we've got u equal to 4 theta. So we'll go ahead and write that down over here so we don't forget. Remember that u is equal to 4 theta. Okay, great. So now we can go ahead and multiply through by 1/2 just to distribute that. So pi over 8. So we'll end up with 1/2 plus 1/2 times cosine of 2u du. And when we integrate, we'll get 1/2 theta, or sorry, 1/2 u. We're still in terms of u. So the integral of 1/2 is going to be 1/2 u. And then the integral of 1/2 cosine of 2u, remember that the integral of cosine is sine. So we'll end up with 1/2 sine of 2u. But then remember that we have to use chain rule here, because since this is more complicated than just the simple variable of u, we've got 2u inside of this cosine function. We have to use chain rule and divide by the derivative of what's inside here. Well, the derivative of 2u is just 2, which means we've got to divide this whole thing, this whole term, by 2. So we went ahead and did that, and we're going to be evaluating this on the range 0 to pi over 8. So let's go ahead and simplify this and plug back in for u at the same time. We'll end up with 1/2 times 4 theta when we plug back in for u into this first term. 4 theta over 2 is just going to give us 2 theta. Then we'll end up, if we bring this 1/2 out in front here and multiply it by the other 1/2, we'll end up with 1/4 sine of 2u. So we get 1/4 times sine, and then 2 times 4 theta is going to give us 8 theta. So sine of 8 theta, and we're going to be evaluating this whole thing still on the range 0 to pi over 8. So now we can go ahead and plug in our limits of integration. We'll plug in our upper limit of integration first, pi over 8. So 2 times pi over 8 gives us pi over 4. So pi over 4, then we get plus 1/4 times sine of 8 times pi over 8 just gives us pi. So that gives us sine of pi. Then we'll subtract and plug in our lower limit of integration. 2 times 0 is just going to give us 0. And then sine of 0, we'll just write that in for now. So 1/4 sine of 0. Okay, so now we don't need this anymore because we already plugged back in for u. Now we're going to go ahead and solve this thing. So a equals pi over 4, and then sine of pi, go ahead and look at your unit circle, look for the angle pi, and then because we're dealing with sine here, you want the y-coordinate there, which is going to be 0. So 1/4 times 0 just gives us 0. This whole term is going to cancel. Obviously, this term is 0. And then sine of 0 here, sorry, that looks like theta. Sine of 0 is also going to be 0, which means this whole term goes away and becomes 0. And you can just see that we're left with simply pi over 4. And therefore, the area bounded by one loop of this polar function here is pi over 4. So that's the area bounded by each one of these loops, this blue area here. The area of that loop is pi over 4, the area of this loop is pi over 4, and all of the loops in this eight-looped flower are the same. So the area of each one is pi over 4. That's it. I hope this video helped you guys, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!